Dear students, in this lesson, we learn three important cognitive aspects: memory, thinking, and problem solving. What is memory? We remember so many things from our childhood. How do we remember all these things? This is due to a dynamic and vast system in all of us, which is known as memory. Memory is an organism's ability to store, retain and subsequently retrieve information. The human memory has immense potential. Psychologists consider memory and learning to be different processes, though both are closely related. Learning refers to the acquisition of new behaviors through experience. Memory refers to the process of storing information that can be retrieved when required. Memory refers to the set of processes involved in storing information, and the specific process is termed as retention. Cognitive psychologists define memory as a perceptually active mental system that receives, encodes, modifies, and retrieves information. Memory is one of the most important cognitive functions, yet one of the easiest to overlook. Students, can we observe memory? We can't directly observe the process of memory. It can be studied indirectly by way of measuring retention. Three basic methods of measuring retention are recognition, recall, and relearning. Recognition is the process of checking the present stimulus with our memory content to find out the match. For example, when we are not able to remember someone's name, but we know that we have seen her face before. Recall. Recall is a process of using general stimulus and finding the information that is in the memory. When one tries to remember a name without a face in front, it is called as recall. Example, while writing essay type answers in the exam, we use the process of recall. Identify and match it with the information which is already stored in our memory. Recognition is more successful because it is easy. Relearning. Relearning is the method of learning the material second time. It usually takes less time than original learning. Let us now discuss the process of memory. Information must be put into memory before any piece of information can be remembered. From an information processing perspective, there are three main stages in the information and retrieval of memory. They are encoding or registration, storage, retrieval or recall. Encoding or registration is the processing and combining of receiving information from sense organs. The process of encoding need not be deliberate one, wherein a person tries to commit something to memory by rehearsal. Instead, encoding happens even without a person's awareness. Storage is the creation of permanent record of the encoded information. This process involves maintaining the coded information within the memory system. Many pieces of information are stored over a long period of time. Retrieval or recall is calling back the stored information response to some cue for use in process or activity. This is the final process of memory that involves finding the information in storage and then bringing to awareness or consciousness. The reasons we cannot remember a piece of information include: information was not encoded or was not encoded properly, the information was lost in the storage, and the information could not be retrieved from storage, or any of these three. Memory is classified into sensory memory, short-term memory, and long-term memory. Sensory memory corresponds approximately to the initial 200 to 250 milliseconds after an item is perceived. The ability to look at an item and remember what it looks like with just a second of observation or memorization is an example of sensory memory. In short-term memory, some of the information in the sensory memory is then transferred to short-term memory. Short-term memory allows one to recall to as long as a minute without rehearsal. Its capacity is also limited. For example, remembering a phone number while dialing. The number in the memory stays a short period of time. After dialing, we may forget the number. In long-term memory, The storage in sensory memory and short-term memory has a strictly limited capacity and duration, which means that information is available for a certain period of time, but it is not retained indefinitely. In contrast, long-term memory can store much larger quantities of information for potentially unlimited duration, sometimes a whole lifespan. Example, a poem we learnt in the childhood will remain for a longer period of time. Types of memory as per recent views. In recent years, psychologists have conceptualized memory into four types. Semantic. This deals with knowledge, meaning and generalized experiences. Whatever you remember from books, information about the world, events is included in it. Episodic memory. It refers to the experience which are personal to an individual. Example, there are so many things we do in a day. Memory of such experiences are accessible by an individual only. They are part of episodic memory. Procedural memory. This deals with memory of our actions, of ways of doing certain things or performing certain activities. Meta memory. It is a memory of individual memory. We not only remember things but also remember what we can remember. People may be good or bad in understanding their own memories. Memory and construction. Memory is not like a tape recorder in which information are contained and retrieved when desired. It has been found that when we encode information or store it or retrieve it, we are actively involved. Our past experiences and their memories also influence. As a result of our memories of events, films, discussions and stories, etc., often become a constructive and reconstructive process. We will realize that when people talk about certain events, their version often differs. In fact, people often add, subtract, or intensify the material that was experienced. This often happens. Thus, our memories are susceptible to change. Strategies for improving memory. Biological waves. Biologically, the best way to improve memory seems to be to increase the supply of oxygen to the brain. Cognitive strategies. There are several principles that are relevant to improve memory about different things. Relevant to this concern include elaborative recursal, level of processing organization, unchunking, encoding, minimizing interference, and reduction of discrepant information. For instance, the technique using the shortcuts like SMART, specific, measurable, attainable, responsive, and time-bounded to remember the systems of objective. The SQ3R process involves 5 steps: survey, question, read, recite, and review. Each promotes more extensive processing of the material being read. Memory is the sum totals of what we remember and gives us the capacity to learn and adapt from previous experiences as well as to build relationship. It is the ability to remember past experiences and the power or process of recalling to mind previously learned facts, experiences, impressions, skills and habits. It is the store of things learned and retained from our activity of experience, as evidenced by modification or structure or behavior or by recall and recognition. Dear learners, now let us learn the concept of thinking. Cognitive abilities like thinking, reasoning and problem solving may be considered to be some of the chief characteristics which distinguish human beings from other species, including the higher animals. The challenges and problems faced by an individual or by society in general are solved through series of efforts involving thinking and reasoning. The powers of thinking and reasoning may thus be considered to be the essential tools for the welfare and meaningful existence of the individual as well as society. Let us consider a few definitions given by psychologists. According to Ross, thinking is a mental activity in its cognitive aspect or mental activity with regard to psychological aspects. According to Garrett, thinking is a behavior which is often implicit and hidden and in which symbols are ordinarily employed. According to Glimmer, thinking is a problem-solving process in which we use ideas or symbols in place of overt, which mean open or unconcealed activity. Considering various definitions, we can say thinking is a mental behavior wherein ideas, pictures, cognitive symbolizations or other hypothetical components of thought are experienced or manipulated. In this sense, thinking is inclusive of imagining, recalling, solving problems, free association, daydreaming, concept formation, and a variety of other procedures. Thinking is a mental process that allows a person to model the world and to deal with it effectively to according to their goals, plans, ends, and desires. Moreover, thinking involves the cerebral manipulation of information as one from concepts, engage in problem solving, reason, and make decisions. Types of thinking. Thinking can be classified into different types. Perceptual or concrete thinking. This is the simplest form of thinking. The basis of this type is perception, that is, interpretation of sensation according to one's experience. It is also called concrete thinking as it is carried out on the perception of actual or concrete objects and events. Here, one makes use of concepts, the generalized objects and languages. It is regarded as being superior to perceptual thinking as it economizes efforts in understanding and problem solving. The second one is reflective thinking. This type of thinking aims in solving complex problems, thus it requires reorganization of all the relevant experiences to a situation or removing obstacles instead of relating with what experiences or ideas. This is an insightful cognitive approach in reflective thinking, as the mental activity here does not involve the mechanical trial or error type of efforts. In this type, thinking processes take all the relevant facts arranged in a logical order into an account in order to arrive at a solution of the problem. Creative thinking. This type of thinking is associated with one's ability to create or construct something new, novel, or unusual. It looks for new relationship and associations to describe and interpret the nature of things, events, and situations. Here, the individual himself usually formulates the evidences and tools for its solution. For example, scientists, artists, or inventors. Skinner, the famous psychologist, says, creative thinking means that the prediction and interference for the individual are new, original, ingenious, and unusual. The creative thinker is one who expresses new ideas and makes new observations, new predictions, and new inferences. The fourth one is critical thinking. It is a type of thinking that helps a person in stepping aside from his own personal beliefs, prejudices, and opinion to sort out the faiths and discover the truth even at the expense of his basic belief system. Here one resort to set higher cognitive abilities and skills for the proper interpretation, analysis, evaluation, and inference, as well as explanation of the gathered or communicated information, resulting in a purposeful, unbiased, and self-regulatory judgment. An ideal thinker is habitually inquisitive, well-informed, open-minded, flexible, fair-minded in evaluation, free from personal bias and prejudices, honest in seeking the relevant information, skilled in the proper use of the abilities like interpretation, analysis, synthesis, evaluation, and drawing conclusion and inferences, etc. The critical thinking is of a higher order, well-disciplined thought process which involves the use of cognitive skills like conceptualization, interpretation, analysis, synthesis, and evaluation for arriving at an unbiased, valid, and reliable judgment of the gathered or communicated information or data as a guide to one's belief and action. The fifth type is non-directed or associative thinking. There are times when we find ourselves engaged in a unique type of thinking which is non-directed and without a goal. It is reflected through dreaming and other free-flowing, uncontrolled activities. Psychologically, these forms of thought are termed as associative thinking. Here, daydreaming, fantasy and delusions all fall in the category of withdrawal behavior that helps an individual to escape from the demands of the real world by making his thinking phase non-directed and floating, placing him somewhere, ordering something unconnected with his environment. We hear there is nothing seriously abnormal in behavior involving daydreaming and fantasy, but the behavior involving delusions definitely points towards abnormality. A person under the influence of such delusions may think or believe that he is a millionaire, a ruler of the universe, a great inventor, a noted historian, or even God. In contrast, a person in this grip of delusion may be inclined to be the most incapable, unworthy, and unwanted person, and may develop guilty feelings or complain that he is the victim of incurable physical or mental diseases. Development of thinking. Thinking is one of the most important aspects of learning process. Our ability to learn and solve the problems depends upon our ability to think correctly, which helps us in adjustment and is necessary for successful living. Only those men who can think distinctively, constructively and carefully can very much contribute something worthwhile to the society. And no person is born thinker. One has to acquire knowledge of technique and practice of proper thinking. There are few methods which help to develop thinking through training. The first method is adequacy of knowledge and experience. Adequacy of the knowledge and experience is considered to be the background of the systematic thinking. So, care should be taken to help the children with adequate knowledge and experiences, which can be done by training the children to enhance the process of sensation and perception to gain better knowledge and experience to improve critical thinking. A person should be provided with opportunities for gaining adequate experience and should be encouraged for self-study, discussion and participation in healthy and stimulating activities. The second point is adequate motivation and definiteness of the aims. Motivation helps in mobilizing our energy for thinking. It creates genuine interest and voluntary attention in the process of thinking and thus helps a lot in increasing the adequacy and efficiency of our thinking. Thus, one should try to think on definite lines with a definite end or purpose. The problems we solve should have intimate connection with our immediate needs and basic motives, and such a thinking should be directed on creative and productive activities. Adequate freedom and facilities are also important. Thinking should not be obstructed by imposing unnecessary restrictions and narrowing of the field of thought process. If the past experiences or habitual methods do not help in solving the problem, we should strive for new association, relationship and possibilities for arriving at satisfactory results. Another one is the incubation. When we set up ourselves to solve problem but fail to solve it in spite of our strain, putting more efforts to thinking and persistent thinking, it is better to lay aside the problem for some time and relax for a while or engage in some other activity. During this interval, a solution is evolved to that specific problem through the efforts of our unconscious mind. This phenomenon of incubation is helpful. Intelligence and wisdom is also helpful. Intelligence is defined as the ability to think properly, and thus proper development of intelligence is essential for bringing adequate thinking. Proper care should be taken to use intelligence, wisdom and other cognitive abilities for carrying out the process of thinking. The other important aspect is the proper development of concept and language. Concept is a word or idea with a generalized meaning which represent an entire class of objects, ideas or events. For example, a word sari is a concept which you think this is this word. It represents all kinds of saris, which are 6 yards or 8 yards long saris made of silk, cotton, nylon or mixture of the concept of the formation begins in early childhood, which are first hand face to face example. It can be positive or it can be negative. Language is highly developed system symbols in which words within a grammar can be written or spoken in different combinations, much of the thinking depends upon language, although some imaging are also present. Concepts, symbols, signs, words, and language are the vehicles as well as instruments of thought. Without their proper development, one cannot proceed effectively on the path of thinking. Their development stimulates and guides the thought process. Improper development and faulty formation of concepts and likewise symbolic behavior not only hampers a person's progress in thinking but also proves fatal, as they may provoke perverted thinking and wrong conclusions. Adequacy of reasoning process. Thinking is also influenced by the mode of reasons one adopts. Illogical reasoning often leads to incorrect thinking. Logic is the science of correcting reasoning, which helps to think correctly. Therefore, we should cultivate the habit of logical reasoning among our children. Thinking and problem solving are closely related. What is a problem? Whenever a goal-oriented activity is blocked, or whenever a need remains unfulfilled or unresolved, there is a problem. Solving a problem usually involves discovering a correct response to a new situation. It involves appropriate combination of concepts, ideas, and skills. Problem solving is part and parcel of our daily life. Every day we solve a number of problems ranging from simple to complex. Some problems take little time, whereas some take much time to solve. We look for alternative solutions if we do not get the right kind of resources to solve the problem in hand. In the case of solving any type of problem, our thinking becomes directed and focused, and we try to use all the resources, both internal, that is mind, and external, which include support and help of others, to arrive at the right and appropriate decision. There are a number of rigid psychological steps involved in problem solving, which is also referred as problem solving cycle. These steps are in sequential order. Here are the steps involved in problem solving approved by an expert psychologist. The first one is the awareness of the problem. The first step in the process of problem solving is the awareness of the problem. Let us take an example. Let us say you are having trouble with your studies. Identifying the root of your failure is your first priority. The problem here could be that you have not been allocating enough time for your studies, or you have not tried the regular techniques. But if you make an assumption that the problem here is the subject being too hard, you won't be able to solve the problem. Identifying the problem seems like the obvious first step, but it is not exactly as simple as it sounds. People might identify the wrong source of a problem, which will render the steps thus carried on useless. For instance, let us say you are having trouble with your studies. Identifying the root of your failure is your top priority. The problem here could be that you have not been allocating enough time for your studies, or you have not tried the right techniques. But if you make an assumption that the problem here is subject of being too hard, you won't be able to solve the problem. Defining the problem. It is vital to properly define the problem once it has been identified. Only by defining the problem, further steps can be taken to solve it. To defining the problem, we also need to take into consideration different perspectives to understand any problem. This will also help look for solutions with the different perspectives. Let us consider the previous example. You have identified the problem as not being able to allocate enough time for your studies. You need not sort out the reason behind it. Have you just been postponing your studies? Have you been too busy with other work? Or you have been spending more time in using mobile phone? You need to understand the whole problem and reasons behind not allocating enough time for your studies. Thus, defining or understanding problem is the second step in problem solving. Forming the strategy. Developing a strategy is the next step to finding a solution. Each different situation will require formulating different strategies, also depending on individual's unique preferences. Now you have identified the study problem. You cannot just simply jump into trying to solve it. You can't just quit work and start studying. This drastic decision may not work most of the time. You need to draw up a strategy to manage your time properly. Allocate less time for not so important work and add them to your study time. Your strategy should be well thought so that you are able to manage enough time to study properly and not fail in the exams. Organizational information is another important step. You need to consider, what do you know about the problem? What do you not know about the problem? Accuracy of the solution for your problem will depend on the amount of information available. We need to now gather information available for the problem. You need to now contemplate on the information available for the subject matter. Repeatedly ask these two questions mentioned to find out more about the problem. Proper organization of the information will force you to revise your strategy and refine it for best result. Allocating resources is another important aspect. Time, money, and other resources are not unlimited. Deciding how high the priority is to solve your problem will help you determine the resources you will be using in your course to find the solution. If the problem is important, you can allocate more resources to solving it. However, if the problem is not important, it is not worth the time and money you might spend on it if not for proper planning. For instance, let us consider a different scenario where your business deal is struck, but it is few thousand miles away. Now you need to analyze the problem and the resources you can afford to expand to solve the particular problem. If the deal is not really in your favor, you could just try solving it over the phone. However, more important deals might require you to fly to the location in order to solve the issue. Monitoring the progress is also important. You need to document your progress as you are finding a solution. Do not rely on your memory, no matter how good your memory is. Effective problem solvers have been known to monitor their progress regularly. And if they are not making as much progress as they are supposed to do, they will re-evaluate their approach or look for new strategies. Problem solving is not an overnight deed. It takes time and patience. Likewise, you need to work towards solving any problem every day until you finally achieve the results. One way to make sure that you are on the right path to solving a problem is by keeping track of the progress. To solve the problem, you can take self-test every week or two and track your progress. Evaluating the results, your job still is not done. Even if you have reached a solution, you need to evaluate the solution to find out if it is best possible solution to the problem. The evaluating might be immediate or might take a while. To conclude, I state once again that cognitive abilities like memory, thinking and problem solving are considered some of the chief aspects which distinguish human beings from other species. Thank you, students, for your kind attention.